And this is the Desert Dogs. Desert, I saw a creature, naked, bestial, who, squatting upon the ground, held his heart in his hands and ate of it. I said, "Is it good, friend?" "It is bitter, bitter," he answered, "but I like it, because it is bitter and because it is my heart." The El Paso Wilderness. It seems we are miles away from civilization, but the closest town is only 10 miles away. A small town of 1,000 souls called Inyokern. However, only 10 miles away from Inyokern lies a secret wilderness. The highest peak in the El Pasos is called Black Mountain, which we shouldn't confuse with the Black Mountain Wilderness near Barstow. Black Mountain is a place that was deemed so holy by Indians that rock art can be found for miles around it. And on top of the mountain, it is said there is an area that has been flattened for ceremonial reasons. There are even rumors of Paiute mummies, hundreds of years old, said to have been placed in hidden crevices. But today, we're just exploring the foothills west of Black Mountain, where there's a small creek that was presently dried up, but apparently provides enough water for a small grove of trees. Marty, the entomologist, was quite happy to see the relatively lush vegetation, a marked improvement over Little Lake. He could even be seen sitting underneath trees in the middle of the creek, almost like he was summoning insects.
As you know, in the desert, it's a really hot and dry environment, and there is barely any rainfall or precipitation per year, only a couple of inches to maybe even less than an inch per year. So what happens is a lot of the organisms in the desert learn to take advantage of what little water source that there may be. And as you can see here, there's a little water source right here. It's stagnant water, but many animals will take advantage of this water source, and we have evidence here to see what kind of animals actually came by. Oops. You can see right here these tracks, distinct bird tracks. Those are the tracks of a roadrunner, you know, the beep beep type of bird. And then right here we have paw prints, which could have came from a coyote. And then right here you can see smaller paw prints, which might have came from a raccoon or a ringtail. So you can see that even the smallest water source will attract many, many different kinds of organisms because of the scarcity of water in the desert. This is one of the indigenous species of tarantulas that you can find in California. The species name of this is actually Eurypelma californicum, or California desert tarantula. And this guy right here is a male, and you can tell that because on his two front appendages, which are called pedipalps, he's got these little boxing glove type apparatus things, and those are actually his sexual reproductive organs. And what he would do is he would find a female and put those little boxing gloves into her sexual reproductive organ parts, and then fertilize. And then you get new tarantulas.
Maybe that's why he was in such a hurry.
Probably.
Yeah, they don't bite.
Not unless I go like that.
Yeah. You
know. Grab him.
This one's pretty cool too, because it's like a light brownish color. The ones that you see in like Angeles National Forest and the lower deserts are actually black and dark gray. Scentless plant bug. Well, this is actually the, the scentful plant bug, but or common name known as the stink bug. This is just a juvenile. You can tell because it doesn't have any wings yet. And the family it is in is pentatomidae, meaning five-segmented antennae. And this feature is completely unique to this family. Now, unlike the other bug, this one will emit a really strong smelling scent as a defense.
But it's obviously a totally different kind of stink bug, right? Not the kind that people normally, when you see a little black beetle, you know, oh, it's a stink bug.
Oh yeah, not the stink beetle. This is the right. Stink bug.
Oh, I see. So,
and yes, you can smell it stinking.
Is it?
It has a really distinct smell. Yeah.
Along the ridge that overlooks the creek, we found a series of rock art. One looked like a helmeted man. And people who are more prone to ufology and conspiracy theories say it is proof that aliens came to the desert. I'm generally skeptical about such claims, but I won't deny that it's fun to speculate.
Like a headdress of some sort. And he is over something else. Regardless, if you look in this little canyon here, you'll see cottonwood trees, desert, and those can only grow where there's water. There was a little pipe thing over here. Actually, the water level's probably really close to the surface, but anyhow, this drew people for a long, long time. And as you can see, there's a lot of petroglyphs up here. This isn't a prime example, but it's just a simple example right here next to our campsite. And due to the heavy revarnishing of these petroglyphs, they're definitely pretty old. And we found some that are not so revarnished. We actually found some petroglyphs that are on top of other petroglyphs. So that's just a good indicator people have been coming here for a really long time. The historic Indians that lived in this area was the Kauai Sioux, but I believe that what we've been finding and what we've been seeing probably predates that. So there, I don't know what else to say about that.
During a night hike, desert holy man Nacho Perez found an interesting obsidian point. It looked like an arrowhead, but it was a little bigger than average. Our closest guess is that it was a desert side-notched arrowhead that was created bigger by accident. Perhaps the man who made the arrowhead left it on the ground after realizing that it didn't have much range. Or perhaps it was made by someone who was inexperienced at creating points.
That's a good one.
Southern California firestorm situation.
When it was time to leave, the fires were raging back home in Los Angeles, and there was concern that we would hit traffic. Fortunately, for us at least, there was only one major fire on our route home, and it was not affecting traffic. But that didn't stop the girls waiting for us back home to be worried about us.
I know.
Okay.
Hey, Ben.
Hi.
That's good stuff.
Hey, yeah.
I was wondering where the fires were. What freeway are you by? I've been like doing this all morning, so what freeway are you by?
We're on the 395
right now.
395. We kind of have to hurry because my battery's going to die.
Someone else has phones there.
No, they're all dead.
This is Andy Curry. Let's try and keep